Hello. Okay, hey. Hello and welcome to my talk. I hope everyone enjoyed the lunchtime so far and the interesting talks that we hear today morning. My name is Manuel Birke. I come from Daimler, and I want to talk a little bit about what we experienced last year with Cloud Foundry. I do not want to talk about the awesome technology. I think every one of us is aware of that Cloud Foundry is a very awesome technology. But I do want to talk about if you decide to use Cloud Foundry for your project, so what are the keys to success to introduce this technology to your enterprise business? Especially in enterprise, you have some certain environment you have to face, and there is a very special to deal with. And if you are in an agile project, this is not always without friction. And so here are some of the keys to success so that you can have a smooth and successful high-performance development process. So we started last year because we wanted to build a connected car product, a connected car app, for our customers, and as we always are interested in bringing up the newest technology to a luxury product for our customers, we decided to go with like the state-of-the-art technology stack and decided to use Cloud Foundry, especially Pivotal Cloud Foundry, for our connected car product that we wanted to launch in Germany to the IAA. So the specialty was that we have only 6 months for the development. So we had a product in place already. This was developed around like 2 years and was already very mature. But now we wanted to bring this to the next level, basically having a more delightful app. And one key to achieve this is to change your development process, to get early customer feedback, to really bring the product to the next level so that everyone has a very delightful experience within our luxury products. So our mission was to exactly build this app and to start with an MVP and iterate over it using fast customer feedback and to release this on the IAA with a high quality that is basically necessary if you want to bring a luxury product to our customers. They have a certain expectation, so we cannot drop in quality. This was one of the requirements once we started with this project. So if you look to now the symptoms in a complex system landscape, so what do you exactly are facing if you want to do an agile project within your company, especially in an enterprise? You have a lot of specification-driven development processes around you, and they are very mature, right? They are already like 20 years old, and we have a lot of legacy and systems that are using it, and that's very mature, and people get used to it. So usually you do like this, writing a specification, and someone will implement this. After that, you do like an acceptance, and everything is fine. You can release this now. With that, you have like schedule-driven development cycles. This is also necessary because you are not alone inside an enterprise. You have a lot of small projects. They are kind of interfacing to each other. You have a very complex system landscape. They have different development roadmaps. So you need a kind of like a schedule-driven enterprise deployment plan, so that you can do at the end an integration, right? And this comes to this point of complex integration. If you have a lot of systems surrounding you, the integration is not really trivial. It is more like complex because of the distribution of the systems. So you don't have like this one foundry where you can look into Logstash and say like, okay, microservice A makes a problem, so I have to do something against this. So we have 10 different systems. They ideally feed everything into one like logging facility, but this is not necessarily the case. So the integration gets complex there. Then also because an enterprise has a long history, and we at Daimler as well, we have different software stacks. And this is totally valid because as we are all engineers, we want to choose the right technology for the right problem, right? So not necessarily Cloud Foundry will fit to all the problems you want to tackle, so we will have different kinds of software stacks, and you need to kind of manage so that they all work together. And Cloud Foundry will help here a little bit. I come to this point later on, but this is where we are now. And then what's also very true is that you want to maintain stability. So last minute refactorings is basically a no-go if you're an enterprise environment, because at the end you need to deliver something for the customer, and sometimes the mindset is there that refactoring can cause more damage instead of doing good things to your code. And therefore, I think one key is to maintain stability here. So if you see these symptoms and you want to go like agile or dynamic with Cloud Foundry and make a more disruptive approach here, you need to like overcome some of these things. How do you do this? You need, from my point of view, four elements to be successful in this kind of environment. One element is you need to be dynamic. So yourself, you need to have a mindset that is very like, I don't really want to use the word agile or disruptive, but it's very dynamic. So you need to see where are the pitfalls, where are the blockers, how can I achieve to enable my team to work even more faster with a leaner development process. This is one thing. The other thing, and this comes with Cloud Foundry, I think these days, because not every one of the OEMs, especially in automotive, has a lot of experience with these kinds of new technologies. So you need to select a partner that is also be dynamic. And this is also, from my point of view, a very important thing, because we in an automotive company, we want to build vehicles, right? This is our business. So if we can partner with people that basically their core business is to develop software, then we can learn a lot from them. And so we can bring this back to our products and make our products even better, because we can synthesize the knowledge that we have from the engineering point of view with the knowledge a partner has, and we did this as Pivotal last year, a partner has from a software development point of view. And also we can adopt this and learn and try to basically incubate this new process into our company to really bring our development to the next level. The third thing is your platform needs to be dynamic, of course. If you have like a platform where your deployment takes 5 days, you really cannot be dynamic or like agile. So you need something that supports that. Cloud Foundry, from my point of view, is currently the best solution for exactly that element. And another thing is that your process needs to be dynamic. Now you can start off thinking about, I take the Scrum process A, or I take a V model, XP, or whatever. You need to decide whatever fits best to you. And again, here, the partner can help you because they have experience in how you bring basically a dynamic process within a dynamic platform to your business. So I don't want to talk about us or our partner. I think everyone knows the companies very well. I want more talk about like the platform and the process. So if you talk about the platform, so by side technology, what is now important if you want to leverage Cloud Foundry? One key focus area is the architecture. If you go like in an agile project, I heard a lot of, let us not think about architecture. Let us do it, try it, iterate over it, and then we improve it. To a certain extent, this helps and this works, but sometimes there is a downside here. It is, if you want to have like a sustainable architecture, then it's always not the smartest idea to just try to iterate to that, right? So with basically no ideas what you want to do up front, with no vision, then this can end up in a dead end. So what you want to do is, especially if you have a complex system around you, you want to basically embed your architecture into that. So you need to have like a short-term approach to iterate and to improve your business, but you should have like a midterm and long-term vision to where you want to go with this company, with this platform, basically. The second thing is the integration. As we already have seen in the first slide, it's like integration can be complex because we have different systems. We want to really interface to these systems, so we need to make sure that if we build something new that is agile, can integrate with the landscape that is currently in the company. The next thing is open source. I think these days there is a mindset outside that open source comes for free. I think we at Daimler are thinking that open source is very necessary to evolve products in a very quickly way, and we are encouraged to use open source where we can. We also recognize that it is important to have partners that basically touch base with open source and create an evolution in these products. As I said, we are not like a software engineering company. We are building vehicles. For us, it is important that the partner we are working with is basically encouraged in open source. So this is why I think all the big companies here in the Valley that are encouraged in open source are going in the right direction. Although I understand, and I think this is very important, if you use open source technology, you have a responsibility to contribute. If you don't do this, then you have basically a vendor lock that's called open source, right? Because you cannot influence where this open source movements go to. And then basically, it can happen that Cloud Foundry goes to a way where we at Daimler cannot use it anymore. And then our investment will be gone. So this is why I think contribution to open source is always necessary. The next thing is like continuous integration. Although it is necessary for your process to continuously integrate and enable the developers to really fast go on the platform, do a CF push, right? You need to do this in a really holistic way. So if you have interfacing systems, you need to kind of like get them on board so that they basically at least can support your agile integration process. And also what we did is like we shipped just an S-class from Sindelfing to Palo Alto. Our development was in Palo Alto. And so we just parked it right next to the developers and said like, okay, if you want to have continuous integration, one end is vehicle, the other end is the apps that you are doing. So please go ahead and do continuous integration. So what you need to do is enable the project that is basically agile to make this continuous integration happen, even though the system landscape you are in is complex. So this is one of the key successor for us. As we have now the platform in place and we know the key areas where we have to be a little bit more careful, we also lead the process, right? So we decided last year to go with the Pivotal Labs guys and doing like a joint project and an enablement project. So this project was roughly 6 months, and it was like divided in basically two parts. One part was more the part of getting everything started, right? Thinking about what is the project we want to do, what is the MVP we want to do, and then they have this kind of like discovery and framing phase where you just say, okay, what is the delightful part we want to bring? And then the developers came back with the reality, this is the framing, this is what you really want to do and we can do, right? Because you have certain technology restrictions. And after that phase, we went into kind of like a iterative approach where we basically from iteration to iteration created use cases and got feedback back from the customers and from like user studies that we did. And this feedback went directly into the use case. And also in this project was very special. It was like international over four time zones. So four different project groups are involved in that. And so we did this kind of follow the sun model. I don't know if everyone is familiar with that. That means in Germany, and some people are laughing here because they worked in this project. For some of us, the sun was never down, right? So, but it started with in Germany. They got a new build. They integrated this build against the vehicles and the whole fleet of vehicles. And then at the end of their business day, they basically reported the errors back to us. And then the next morning, we started with a team on working on these errors, fixing them, do a CF push, deploying this, and then next day, people in Germany could continue on integrating that. So, and there you, I think you see really the value that the platform and the process brings you, right? So you have the opportunity to work with good people that are familiar how to deal in this agile environment, and you have the platform that supports that, and you need both, right? What is now the key focus if you want to sustain this, right? Because we did this. Nowadays, we are living this. We are not living this in like a 5 month cycles. We are living this now in 2 month cycles. So we could improve this over the time. So, but what does it take to come to this point? So in this picture, you see like you are dynamic, but your world is not dynamic around you. So you need to kind of like influence, inject them somehow, right? So you do this by ensuring that your organization will adopt the new process and see the value in it. So we have seen, we heard this in the talks in this morning, especially here in this room. Transparency is here a very, very important thing. So you need to make sure that everyone understands what is your mission, what is the value of the mission, and how can they participate in that. So we did this, and it was a very, very well seen approach, and people liked it and tried to adopt this and tried to work with us in this model. The next thing, because what you cannot do is you cannot say, like, I do an agile project and everyone now needs to follow me. This will not happen, especially not if you have like very complex systems around you. So we are talking about like 40 to 50 different systems with different release plans. So they will not adopt what you have in mind, right? So you need to align to this enterprise development plan. And here's, I think, the takeaway that is very important. You need to have like a hybrid approach. You need to be like agile, and you need to have your sprints and be like very continuously. But you also, and this is especially also true for the architecture, right? You need to have like a midterm and a long-term vision how you can interface to different other processes in your company, to different other development plans. And this is basically the last key here. It's make sure that you can kind of decouple your process from the world around you, so that you are not depending on development cycles that maybe are not basically synchronizing you. So what you want is like doing your development and doing it in your own way, but also contribute in the bigger system. And this is why interfacing is a very important takeaway here. So we did this with like kind of integration parties. This was not really big bang. We heard this already in the morning. You are better if you do like feature toggling. So you're enabling, disabling certain features. You can evolution your code. You can deploy your code. At the end, you can just enable and disable certain features. And this is also a good strategy if you don't want to have like a big bang integration. You want to smoothly integrate with the other systems and give them the time to attach to your software as well. So if we have now the process and we have now the platform, one would say everything is fine, no, go ahead, we are successful. But we aren't. We are only then successful if we really live this development process. And with live the development process, I really mean be part of the team. So one thing you should not do is like, okay, yeah, I grab now some guys like Pivotal, for example, with labs. I have like 20 developers sitting there aside. They will do the show and everything is fine. This will not work, especially in a complex environment. You need to like really bring the subject matter experts into the team, so that the developers can interface with the engineers and with the integration engineers, for example. And this is also very important because you want to take away the knowledge in this project, right? So you want to sustain this somehow. The next thing is like pair together. So I'm not sure if everyone is doing this practice because pair programming, someone would say it is not very sufficient or efficient or it's like expensive. From my point of view, it's absolutely necessary. So if you don't pair, you will lose a lot of opportunity. And you will lose a lot of knowledge transfer that really will reduce your bus count. So pairing together, from my point of view, and I'm already since a couple of years in the industry developing in from rational unified process to V model to XP, everything. Pairing, I think, it's a key element for success here. And also, you need to bring a certain mindset into the team. So you need to have the mindset of lose and win together. So every time something went wrong, the team was responsible for fixing that. They fixed it overnight. And the next time, everything was happy because the software was correct. And so you need to motivate this team culture. And you do this automatically if you are part of the team, right? The next thing is more like from a refactoring and code development point of view. You need to treat change as a chance to make your code quality better, as a chance to fixing bugs before they arise, right? Also, this goes hand in hand with that you have to see bug fixes as improvement. Or it can happen that people may blame you because you have too many bugs in a software, but you should get to the mindset of, I need to fix it because I want to increase the quality, I want to increase the user experience, I want to ship a product that basically fulfills the quality requirements that I want to bring to my customer. And we did this. So the team worked very hard on fixing bugs and bringing the highest quality that led to almost no complaints from the customer side. So I'm very happy about that. And the next thing is do not fear transparency. And I already motivated this quite a few times. I think if you go with a different project and a different process to an enterprise company, you need to make it transparent what you are doing. And then this brings the value for the company because they will see how good this approach is and how you can improve basically your product development process with that. So we accomplished this mission by launching on the IAA. This is like the IAA booth from Mercedes-Me. And so I'm very happy about this. And at this point, a big thanks to all that worked on the team, especially the labs team, also the team in Germany, and the team in London and in Canada. And that's basically my last slide. So you have here an impression of the product itself and the S-Class we shipped to Palo Alto. We also had like iWatch support, for example. It was like very fancy upcoming new technology. So I'm very happy about this project and can say that this was an absolute success that brought a new agile project and process to Daimler and that really brought our product to the next level of quality for our customers. So thank you for that. Any questions? Please come to the mic. Yeah. So we have a similar setup than the guys from I think it was like Digital Globe. So we have like a staging environment. We have Jenkins, continuous integration. And so what we are doing is like we have a very restrictive system landscape. So we have like also a development machine. We have a test machine, integration, acceptance, queue released. And then we have like several Cloud Foundry instances where we have to go through until we release it at the end. And continuous integration is really here a success because we have different vehicles driving on different environments. They are not necessarily all in one environment. And so with a one-click deployment, we can really flush the code on every environment and just go out and like try it on the different kinds of environments. And they have a different grade of stability, right? So in an integration environment, usually you have a full-blown system going on. And on a test environment, maybe you're isolated a little bit more so you can identify bugs. Continuous integration, from my point of view, is absolutely necessary if you want to be in a like a staged enterprise environment. Otherwise, maybe it's not so necessary because you can just do a CF push. If you are like in a startup, a small system, it's fine. But if you're an enterprise, you need this. And our backend that we developed before last year, they did not have a continuous deployment. So we could reduce our deployment time to 25%. So this was really an improvement on the other side. Please.
What I find is every entity is trying to create their own mobile app. So let's say you are an owner, you will have your car app, you need a parking app, a cities app, an airports app. So what's your recommendation about, from an end user perspective, how do you prevent, or how are you thinking to prevent proliferation of mobile apps?
Yeah. So basically the question is, do you want to have an app for a purpose, or do you want only one app, right? It's interesting because I think the big players went through this already quite a few times. So you have like one Google app, and then you have 10 Google apps, and then you have one Google app, and so on. So my personal point of view is that sometimes it makes sense to have separate apps because we have maybe different security restrictions, right? For example, our new E-class that is out there has like a Parkman app, so you can park autonomously. Such an app has different security restrictions, for example, than an app that makes like commercial advertisements, right? So, and what you want is like you want your development process to be like not interfering each other, right? So because on a like a app where you can autonomously park your vehicle, you have another quality restriction that you might not have on the other app. So the process is a very different process. And this is why, at this point, if it comes to this application, it makes sense to divide this into two apps. And then you need to find a balance to always make this delightful, right? So if a customer, so and this is why it's important to have customers, right? So you ask your customer, do you want one app, do you want two apps, do you want three apps? And then at the end, you converge to a solution that is suitable. And this can be very different for every business, right? For us, maybe it is good to have like a connected car app where you can like open and close your doors, or maybe like see what is your state of charge, and also have like a dedicated app for advertising, for example. But there might be a company out there that would say, no, we only want one app. The key point here is, how can Cloud Foundry support this, right? And I think with the microservice architecture, you have already a foundation where you are free to choose whatever you want to, right? Because at the end, this can change over time. Because now the trend is, yeah, let us do an app for purpose. And in 5 years or in 3 years, it can be, no, let us do one app because I don't want to start 10 apps, right? And this is why I think it's more important to talk about the backend part. And if you do this right, you don't even care if it's one app or 10 apps.
Can you talk a little bit about the corresponding changes or engagement with existing partners in the product? You talked a lot about how did the business change and what about that?
That is also an interesting question. So in retrospective, I would say our business improved because we could bring functionality faster to market. So the awareness of our customers is, and this is totally true because we are innovating our products very heavily, right? And that we can do even more for our customers, right? So, and I would say, bottom line, that our business and the awareness of our business changed dramatically from maybe a very sustained development process to a very modern and agile development process. And I think this is also a good takeaway for our customers here.
Cool. Hello, thank you for sharing your experience with us. And earlier you mentioned one thing that was
So question is here, what is our impression about bug fixes, right? And is it only an improvement, and what were we thinking before we went through this process? I think this is a very general question, and I can really answer this general. For myself, bug fixes are always good. So bugs are good, because you can identify problems in your code, right? For a customer, maybe this is not good, because the customer is complaining because something is not working. So you better fix the bugs before you go to production. This is one thing. The other thing to make this to support this, you need to have a very good queue for your application. So what we did is we improved our software quality by having a dedicated queue team at Pivotal Labs, and we also had a dedicated queue team in Germany looking through the software, really using it with different vehicles. And sometimes people will not maybe recognize that a bug is good, but I think it is our responsibility as an engineer to really facilitate and make the transparency that bug fixes are good. And at the end, I would say this is also a process for every company to move forward in the modern software, agile development. You will see more bugs. That is true because you are developing faster. But you can also improve a lot more, right? Because you have shorter development cycles. And this brings you with continuous integration into a position where you easily can fix bugs. Right? Last question.
In terms of the continuous delivery, right, of the new features, so do you schedule those, do you schedule those deliveries on a given time, or because it's going to be disruptive for the end consumer, right, whenever you roll out a new feature? Yeah. So how do you plan out these?
So the question was basically, how did we manage the continuous delivery, right? So so we had like a two-step approach. The first approach was that we have a fully automated continuous deployment process up to the environment where we did like the final acceptance. And after that, we needed to align, and this was also important to all the other processes, when we bring this to market. So this was a manual process. And this is also necessary because think about if you want to go to a market, you need to have much more than just rolling out the software. You need to have like advertisements, you need to have like learnings for the people that sell maybe the product. So it was more like a holistic approach here. And so we need to make sure if you want to go to a certain market that everything that surrounds the app also gets covered. And this is why we really couldn't get in an automatic fashion to the market. We needed to like kind of like plans this out. So we had like continuous integration delivery until queue acceptance, and then we had like the last mile basically manual. Okay. So if someone has any questions, you can free and grab me afterwards. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.